friends, God is great. He's an awesome and amazing God. Psalms 24 simply says, who is the Lord? The Lord God, strong and mighty. I don't know about you, but we serve an awesome and amazing and a mighty God. And when you have a mighty God, you can go through hell and high water and know that you're going to come out on the other end, because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Ain't no sickness can stop him. No disease can stop him. No enemy can come against him. No foe can overtake him. For when the enemy would come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord lifts up a standard against him. And so because I know that I've already won, because I already know I got the victory, because I already know that the fight is fixed, I don't have to wait till the battle is over, but I can give God praise and glory in advance for what he's going to do in my life. And so I've just learned to let that to be the anthem of my life. I've learned that every day that God has given me, he's already given me the victory. He's already given me the outcome. He's already given me the overflow. And so I don't have to wait until it comes to pass, until the check gets in the bank, till the doctor says it's gone. I can stand firmly upon God's word and give him praise, glory, and honor, for he is a great and an awesome and amazing God. I remember when I was young and I used to watch the Lakers, and this was old school Lakers, not when it was on ABC, when it was on CBS with Jim Hill. Still had the same fro that he got now, but Jim Hill was on, and that's when the Lakers would come on late at night. And so what Jim Hill told us, he says that the Lakers was down about 20 points. He says, but they came back in the fourth quarter and they won the game. He says, after the newscast goes off, then they're going to show the game in its entirety. I stayed up and I began to see the game, and the Lakers was falling down 5 points and 10 points and 15 points and 20 points. And I started getting nervous. I started getting excited because I thought the Lakers was going to get put out of the playoffs. But then I remember what Jim Hill told me. Jim Hill told me that this was tape delayed and that the Lakers had came back and had won already. And I don't know what you're going through, what you're up against, what you're facing. And I know what somebody else would tell you, but let me tell you what God's word says. God's word says that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So be encouraged. Be strengthened, because your help is on the way. Well, I am Pastor Philip White, the ongoing every week guest host of A Mother's Cry. So glad to see you on the RMC network. And for those that are watching and following us today on Facebook Live, we're just glad to have another opportunity to come into your homes, come into your jobs. Some of you will watch this on tape delay. You will watch the replay. We're just glad to have this opportunity that we might have fellowship, that we might have koinonia, we might have this time together. And it is our prayer and petition that something will be done, something will be said to deposit hope and to strength and to might into your life, that you will believe that you can go just a little bit further by God's grace and ultimately for his glory. After we always give thanks and praise to God for this amazing opportunity, the next person we got to thank is the founder, and that is Evangelist Shirley Knight Harris, who is the mother of A Mother's Cry. She is the one that after the death of her son, the Lord placed this within her heart, within her spirit, to begin to have a vehicle in which she could reach out to others who are far from God, who have lost their way, who don't believe that there's any hope. And so she has labored and she has sowed in the vineyard. And so we want to give honor and respect to her. We want to continue to keep praying for her as the Lord is continuing his delivering process in her life and in her being and all that she does. We want God just to let her know that he has not forgotten her labor of love. And so we pray a prayer in advance. Gracious Father, we just thank you. We honor you and we bless you for this time that we have of gathering. We pray, God, that your spirit will just go through these airways and over these cameras. And Lord, you will just find good ground in somebody's heart, some daughter, some son, some lost sinner that needs to be drawn to you. We pray and ask, oh God, that you will quicken them and regenerate them as only you can. Touch the founder of this program. Keep her encouraged. Lord, let the resources continue to come that she might be able to continue this God-given vessel. We're going to give your name all praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. And everybody out there saying, thank God.
Thank God.
Amen. No matter where you are, even if you're on your job, just clap real quick. Amen. Just give God a praise. Amen. For his goodness. and for his grace. Well, we encourage each and every one of you, go on to social media, go into Mother Harris's Facebook page, let her know that you're still watching, you're still encouraged, you're still being blessed by the program. And while you're just there trolling, don't look at none of them old crazy videos of folks fighting and folks doing stuff. Go to Pastor Philip White's page. Let him know that you're watching A Mother's Cry and that you're being blessed by the program on today. Those of you that are on social media, we're following you. Mom Patsy, we see you. We love you with the Lord. Sister Lucy Hayton, we see you. And we love you with the love of the Lord. If you want to call in and be a part of the program, we welcome your phone calls, your critiques, your comments. You might just got something you want to add into the pot. This is a pot that we got that's going. So you can always be here. The number is 323-965-1600. Once again, the number is 323-965-1600. Every week when I get off, somebody will tell me later on, man, I wanted to call in and say this. And why did y'all say that? And why y'all didn't hit this point? Call in. And if you call in, you can make your own point. So we encourage you to call in today. Be blessed and to be enjoying this program today. Well, I am blessed and highly favored. I got all of the tables, all of the seats filled on the day. I got some great and awesome men of God. I'll start off with the regular guy who's always riding with us on my side today. He's on right here on the other side of the table with me. He is a minister, one of the preachers at the Greater Union Baptist Church of the City of Compton, California. Reverend Sam Darling, go ahead and say hello to the people on Mother's Cry today.
All right, good to be here as always. And once again, I too thank God for Mother Harris and her vehicle, and it's a wonderful thing. And very good to be here today with you again.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Well, we're ready to jump into it. I got two great and awesome men. I am a part of First Jurisdiction, Church of God in Christ, SoCal. And so we're having our convocation on this week. And so I got some great and awesome powerhouses that were just in the city. And they were so gracious and kind with their time to come and just break away a little bit to be with us on today. We first have Pastor McZeal, who is the senior pastor of Living Water Church of God in Christ in the awesome city of Fontana, California. Pastor McZeal, we're glad to have you. Just greet God's people for a second.
Oh, how wonderful it is to be here. I thank God for this opportunity to come before the people, and I pray that something will be said tonight or today that will bless your heart, that you would just be able to grow stronger in the Lord.
Yes, sir. How's the weather out there in Fontana? I usually go and check out the race sometimes. What's the weather like in Fontana?
Weather right now is very, very hot. We're right now in the 90 degrees right now, and it's pretty warm out there. So actually, it's warm all over, but it's hot out there now.
Bless you, man of God. Pastor Jerry Johnson last night was saying they turned the weather up to 116. I ain't going to Palm Desert for a while, man. He can have Palm Desert right about now. We're also blessed to have one of my good brothers, Superintendent Kevin Moreland. He is the pastor of Worship in Truth Church in San Bernardino, California. He's a superintendent. He's a husband. He's a father. And he's an anointed man of God. Superintendent Moreland, greet God's people.
Bless you, Dr. White. I'm so elated to be here. I'm excited about what God's going to do through us on today. My ears are open, my heart is open, and my mind is open. I'm expecting the Holy Ghost to speak to us and through us on today, that those that may be listening be blessed and edified. And that is our agenda on today, to bring glory to God. So I'm excited to be here. I want God to have his way. So I'm going to move out the way so God can say what he needs to say.
Let's start off with, we always start off with people's moment of faith, of when they came and when they was arrested or regenerated by God. Superintendent Martin, you already have a great testimony that we want to hear for a second. But Pastor McZeal, just talk about, to those that are out there, how did you come to faith? What was the moment? Was it instantaneous? Were you always in the church? Tell us what was your story.
Oh, my story is very, very exciting.
Yes, sir.
One that I'll never, ever forget. I had a brother that was in the Air Force, and he was over in Hawaii. And he came home to visit. Hadn't seen my brother for about 5 years. But when I saw him, there was a glow on his face that when I saw him, I said, I don't know what it is that you got, but I want it.
Yes, sir.
And so he began to minister to me and to share the salvation, the gift of God for me in salvation. And he asked me the question if I was going to heaven or hell. And I said, well, you know, I'm going to heaven. And he said, well, how do you know that? I said, well, my good outweighs my bad. And so that be the case. But he says, no, that's not the word. The word says that you need to be born again. And when he asked me that question, I said, well, then if that's the case, I want to be born again. And ever since then, this was back in 1978, yes, December 28th. That accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of my life, and I've been running for Him ever since. And the glow has not left; it's still there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We that's going to be a whole other program. Is there still a hell, Pastor McZinn?
Oh yes, yeah, most definitely. Yes. All yes. Right. The Bible talks about it. And if you believe the Bible says there is a hell and there is a heaven. And but God said that He wished that none would perish,
yes,
that
sir.
None would go to hell, but that all would come to repentance, that we would be with Him. And so, listen, it's easy, amen, to get to heaven. All you got to do is accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. And if you do that, amen, you are on your way to heaven. Your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Superintendent Moreland, I know you were like, I've heard your testimony. You were like John the Baptist. You was filled with the Holy Ghost in your mother's womb. No, sir. I've heard your testimony. That's not it. Let everybody know how you came to faith, if you don't mind.
Yeah, far from the John the Baptist experience. Although that would have been a wonderful story, but mine was diametrically opposed to that. I live in the IE now, but I'm a byproduct of Los Angeles. I grew up here in Los Angeles, California. I graduated from Dorsey High School.
Yes, sir.
And at an early age, I got involved with the gang life. I was a key leader in one of the blood gangs in Los Angeles, California. I had three rock houses in Los Angeles off of Figueroa. I had several people working for me. And what was transpiring, I had a young man who had been a good friend of mine who was incarcerated. And I was preparing to make sure that I was able to take care of him when he got out of prison. And when he got out, I gave him some drugs. I gave him some money. We put him in an apartment. And he went and did some violent stuff, went right back to jail. And he was in the county jail for 2 weeks. And while he was in the county jail, he died. He got spinal meningitis and he died. So I was here at the funeral. The whole time I was at the funeral, I had just drank 240 ounces of Old English, and I was sitting there, and the question that was running through my mind rapidly was, where is this young man? I had set up an earthly kingdom for him, and now I'm wondering how he just left so easily, and so that began to boggle my mind, and so I started to begin to think about God. My wife at that time was going to church. A church here in Los Angeles. I don't want to mention the name of the church because when I give the testimony, I don't want to put a bad light. And so she was attending the church, and I was going to pick her up from choir rehearsal. And when I was going to pick her up from choir rehearsal, I was an hour late. And she was outside. She was a little bit perturbed. She was waiting for me for an hour. And I was in my lowrider. I pulled up in the car in the parking lot at the church, and because I was looking like a gang member and I was on a lowrider, the security guard walked up to me, and he had a gun on his right hip. And so I grabbed my gun. Yeah, I grabbed my gun from up under my seat. And when he walked up to my car, I pulled my gun on him. I'm like, what do you want? And he said, well, I'm just a security of the church. I'm just trying to make sure everything's all right. I said, well, I'm here to pick up my girl. You know, you just need to get away from my car. And so when my wife got in the car, the entire ride home, I'm like, what kind of church is this? You go to a church where they have guns? And so she was, oh, no, you don't understand. You need to come to church. I said, I'm not going to no church where they packing guns. I said, they just like me. And so suffice to say, she had the pastor to call me. And the pastor called me, explained to me that, you know, this is a different era. You know, sometimes we got to protect ourselves. We have to have security on staff. And you just need to come by the church. I said, man, I'm not coming. And then I was working at McDonnell Douglas, and I was coming back from a lunch break. I just drank me some more alcohol while I was going to work on the airplanes. And something happened to me. Something told me to go to church that night. I went to church that night. There was an evangelist by the name of Fred Williams out of Louisiana. He was preaching, and it seemed like he was preaching and talking directly to me. I looked over to my wife. I said, you must have told this man something about me. She said, I didn't tell him anything. I didn't know you were coming. And so that night I gave my life to the Lord, and I've just been serving the Lord for the last 24 years. It's just been a wonderful ride. I give God all the glory. He's delivered me, snatched me from the pit of hell, and I'm giving him all the glory. And I'm on a mission to reach out to those that are lost.
So young men that are caught in gangs, young men that are caught in drugs, young men that are caught in a lifestyle that's outside of God, there is still hope for those young men. Would you agree with that?
Most definitely. I'm a prime example. I was in it deep. I worked with some of the major drug dealers. If I named them, you would know them. And so I was entrenched deeply into gang activity and also drugs. I was arrested with several kilos of cocaine. They tried to give me 27 years. I beat the case on an illegal search and seizure because I had all the drugs in a young lady's house, and I didn't live there. My name wasn't on the place. They knew it wasn't hers, and they came in the apartment without a search warrant, and I beat the case on an illegal search and seizure. But I know for a fact,
yes, sir,
that God can touch anyone. He can save anyone. Some of the things I've done, I'm not proud of. But I'm thankful that God has thrown my sins into the sea of forgetfulness. Right. But I'm here to testify that if he's done it for me, he can do it for you. You are not beyond the reach of God's hands.
Yes.
He can reach you wherever you are.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, we all got a great testimony of how God bringing us out and God saving our lives. Well, today's program we really want to talk about is the kingdom man.
Yes, sir.
And how God desires that men would be arrested and that men would turn their lives wholeheartedly over to God. Talk about, any brother can jump in, God's desire, it's not specific to men, but he does have a specific desire to have fellowship with men as they are the heads of the household. They are the man in which he started off with that first covenant. Any one of you pastors or preachers can jump in on God's desire for men to walk in fellowship and covenant with him.
Certainly. Well, I really appreciate the brother's testimony because, again, it shows first and foremost how he spoke of how he was arrested.
Yes, sir.
Because of all the things that he did. And then the Spirit of God arrested him again. Yeah. He was arrested for real that time. And he hasn't been let go since.
Yes,
he still got him. He got away that first time.
Yes, sir.
But he can't get away from the Spirit of God. So that's a wonderful testimony. I'm going to give equal time to L.A. High School. I see Dorsey. It's all right. But L.A. High School's in the house, too.
Well, Washington is here, too. We're going to call our schools.
Praise God.
Yes, sir.
But yes, the man is important. And really, I'm touched by the brother's passion because I have a project that I'm working on that's very similar. But the fact of the matter is God uses the man principally. That is not to say that he does not use everybody, but the man is key. The man is the head of the family. The man is the head of everything that God has ordained. One of the most scandalous and most sorrowful parts of this country's history is slavery. And we all know that, and there's still effects from that. But the very first thing that was done was to take that man and separate that man from his family. That's because they knew that once they took the man away and sold him over here, sold the women and children over there, he had weakened that family forever. The man became easier to manipulate and defeat, and the woman and the child were easy prey for him. And so God did the same thing, and we see it in the Bible. We see it in the Bible when Herod heard from the three wise men that the Savior had been born. And Herod sent the wise men to go find out where that Savior is because I want to go and worship him. Well, certainly he didn't want to go to worship him. He wanted to know where he was. And the wise men knew what was going on and left. But the problem is, or the point is, Herod, because he was so afraid of the Son of Man, he was so afraid of him, he ordered the killing of what? Every firstborn male.
Yes.
Because he knew that if he did that, he would get the God man.
Yes.
And so the man has been key from the very beginning. Yes. And we can go back even further than that. The man, even now, we see a lot of injustice in the streets and police brutality and so forth.
Sure.
There's a broad spectrum. But at the heart and at the key, we see some isolated incidents where there was women, but primarily it is the man that is being attacked. It is the man that is being arrested in alarming rates. It is the man that is being attacked because when you control that man, you pretty much control the situation.
Pastor McZeal, statistics tell us that if a woman is the single head of a household, that house has maybe a 40% chance of being won over to Christ. But that if a man is in the home and if he serves the Lord, that house has about a 70% chance. Talk about a man's role or his effect in his household to lead them in the path that God would have for them to be led.
Amen. One of the things that I always like to do, I like to make sure that when we speak, that we're staying with the word.
Yes, sir.
In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 23, it says, "For the husband is the head of the wife,
yes, sir,
even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husband in everything." And then it says, watch this, husbands, what? Love your wife.
Yes, sir.
Love you.
The problem that we're having in the home is that the man is not there in the home.
Yes, sir.
And the children need to see that. And when they see the husband loving the wife, doing things for the wife, taking care for the wife, amen. Opening the door for her when she gets in the car and showing affection. Then that male that's in the home can now see his father doing these things, and then that can raise him up to be the man that God has called him to be. God wants us to be the head.
Yes,
amen.
Sir.
He wants us to be the head of the church. He's called us. The first institution that God established was the marriage.
Yes.
And we've seemed to have gotten away from the marriage. Amen. One of the things that brother has mentioned before, and when we go back into the 60s, one of the things that they did is they started putting the man out of the house.
Yes.
That you could not get welfare or help unless the man was out. And that's what he was trying to break up the family.
Right.
And once you break up the family, amen, then you can break up the church. Once you break up the church, you can break the city and then even our nation. And that's where we're going. So we need to get back to the family. We need to get back to where the man is the head of the household, that he's leading. And the only way that he can really lead is by the Spirit of God in his life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, but to the morning, what does the kingdom man look like? What does he... How can I tell him different from any other man? Is there some components that go into a kingdom man?
Sure. What we have to deal with is what's called in theology the law of first mention. So we must go back to the origin in the book of Genesis, where the Bible said that God created man in his image. And so what man should be, he should be the reflection of God. So when God made him in his image and in his likeness. The Bible said that God changes not, so he doesn't change his purpose. So the purpose of man is to be the reflection and the image of God. We should speak like God. We should talk like God. We should conduct ourselves in the manner of God. Now, how do we do that? We do that through the word of God. No man has seen God at any time. But the Bible says in the book of Romans that we're transformed by the renewing of our mind. So we need to come into the relationship with God. The Bible says in Proverbs 20 and 27, the spirit of man is a candle of the Lord, searching the inward parts. So it means when I get saved, God lights his spirit with my spirit, gives me Zoe, the life of God. It's the eternal, perpetual quality life of God. And I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And so now I must be renewed in my mind, my thoughts. I must become like God. And so since we were having a difficult time coming to that reality from the first 39 books of the Old Testament, God sent Jesus.
Yes, sir.
And Paul talks
sir.
About him in Colossians. He said, well, since you couldn't really get it and see it in those first 39, I'm going to send you the express image of the invisible God. And so the Bible says in Philippians, let this mind be also in you, which was in Christ Jesus. So the pattern for me to be like God in the kingdom is to walk after Jesus and to conduct myself and to function up under the auspice of the words of Christ, and I may live by all the words of Jesus Christ. And so I follow after the pattern. But I want to chime in a little bit earlier what we were talking about as far as dealing with the husband there. Because when we look at the law of first mention, the Bible lets us know that God created man first.
Yes, sir.
Then he made woman. The Bible said that the purpose for the woman, because she was going to be a helpmate, which simply means this, that God created man for his purpose. And God created woman for man. So this threefold cord that's not easily broken simply means that man, if he's going to effectively do what God has called him to do, he must have his hand in God's hand while he's connected to his woman.
All right.
And if he's trying to connect with a woman without being connected to God, then now we have a man without a head.
Yes,
and the Bible said if the blind leads the blind, they both go into the ditch. And so that's the problem we're having. We have men that are disconnected from God.
Yes, sir.
Who are trying to lead people, and they cannot lead because they are disconnected. And so we got to understand that everything that God does is based on according to purpose. I'm going to say this. I'm just going to let somebody else speak, but this may shock you what I'm about to say. And I ask people at my church, I ask them the question, is marijuana good? Is cocaine good? And they start looking at me crazy. And my response to them is, yes. And they look at me crazy. Oh, Pastor, you becoming a heretic. I'm getting ready to walk out, get my Bible, my iPad. I'm out of this church. I said, hold on before you go. If we go back to the book of Genesis, the Bible said that when God made everything, he looked at it. He said, it's all good. Everything is good. And so it lets me know that everything that God has put down on the planet is good, but you should not touch it until you know the purpose of it. The person that's in the neighborhood that I used to sell cocaine to, we would take the cocaine, mix it up with B12 powder, rock it all up, and they would freebase it. Well, the chemists or the doctors, they use it. They use it, and they put it in anesthesia. They put you to sleep, cut you open, take stuff out of you, and you wake up in the recovery room. You're much better. You don't know what happened. So everything that God has put down here is good, but you don't touch it until you know the purpose of it. Because I've been saved all my life. I ain't ever drank since I've been living. Well, you drink some NyQuil. It has alcohol in it. You drink some Geritol, and you were able to get a good night's sleep, and you were able to get 8 hours, and you were able to go to work. So not the person on the corner with a bottle of nitrate in his back pocket. He doesn't know the purpose of it. And so we don't touch anything. And so, man, you must know your purpose. You were created to be the reflection and the image of God, to bring glory to God. You are his supreme creation. And that's what I'm about. I'm trying to awaken men to know that you were made and created in the image and likeness of God. And the image that you're portraying and the images that you're following, they're not in the image of God. And we must stop that.
Let's identify. We'll hit to a break in a second. But the sure. Bible says that Jesus came to condemn the works of sin in the flesh.
Yes.
Many men are being they're caught in bondage to the works of the flesh. So many of our men are struggling. So many of our men are laid captive by the devil. Let's identify some of those areas in which that men seem to be just really struggling, and that God has come, sent his son, that the works of the flesh might be broken in their life. Pastor McZeal, let's just name one that men are struggling with.
I believe that, number one, men are struggling with, they have no objective for their life. They have no purpose for their life, and life seems to be meaningless. And Job said that he knows the way that I take.
Yes, sir.
And when he has tried me, I shall come forth. And so we need to have an objective for life. We need to have a purpose for life. And the purpose that God has called us for is to be a godly man.
Yes, sir.
And so we need to be that godly man that God has called us for. And if we have an objective and a purpose for our life, then we are able to do and meet the will of God, and God will direct us in our way. We have a law against vagrancy. And the laws against vagrancy, you know, it seems to be in the minority, but in the vast majority today, we have a lot of vagrant men in the earth today. They have no fixed course for their lives. They have a life objective. But listen, we ought to have an objective in our life. The gravity of life is short. And it ought to cause us to busy ourselves with meaningful and worthwhile objectives. We ought to put our hands in God's hand and trust God, and God will bring it to pass. The clock of life is wound but once.
Yes.
And we don't know when it's going to stop, at earlier date hour.
Yes,
but
sir.
Now is the only time that we have. And men, we need to use the time that we have now.
Yes, sir.
So that we can fulfill God's will and purpose for our life.
Awesome. Well, darling, any place you see that men really seem to be struggling, or it seems like that the devil, without being surrendered to God, seems to have a foothold?
Well, again, I would say in the homes, and there are a lot of reasons for it: lack of direction, lack of purpose. We touch on them all, and I think it begins there. But certainly there has been a concerted effort to keep men out of the home. It was institutionalized, as the brother mentioned, in the 60s, so that we who were denied so many things that we felt, and most of the world felt, were God-given rights. We were denied those things systematically and institutionally because we of our skin color. And they said, well, we can help you and get these but you got to get that man out of there. You can't have a man in the house if you want this and this and this, as you mentioned. And so it has been a continuous attack on the man, on the institution of marriage. You mentioned marriage being the first institution. The brother mentioned there, and that is indeed true. So what is one of the greatest attacks now on the institution of marriage?
Yes.
On the institution of marriage. All of a sudden they want to say now, not only do you not need to be married as men and women, you don't even need a man to have a marriage. Two women can be married, you see. So they took the attack even further, and it was indeed a conscious attack and a very, I would say, duplicitous attack, because, you know, those who fought for gay rights and so forth, you know, supposedly the action was they were being denied health care. They were being denied monies that their partners left in death, so they couldn't get these various things. So the government said, well, okay, you can have those things. Go ahead and have those things. But then they weren't satisfied with that, which supposedly was the fight. They said, no, not only do we want that, we want marriage to be turned around. We want marriage to be redefined. And man cannot redefine marriage, because man did not define marriage in the first place. It was the Almighty God who instituted marriage. He laid the foundations and the elements of it, and it cannot be changed.
Yes, sir.
He does not change.
Yes, sir. So there are so many areas in which that we are believing God that that men will see the power and the anointing of God upon their life. Sexual addictions, drug addictions, gangs, all kind of perversions. I believe that the power of God is available to break every stronghold that's on every man's life, that he might be able to give his will wholeheartedly over to God. We're going to take a brief break. We'll be right back on A Mother's Cry. God bless you, my friends. Philip White from the Christ Center Church. There is a myth and misnomer that is spread around the world that people believe that under authority is less valuable than being in authority. That if I'm under authority, my value exits, and if I'm in authority, my value is added. Because of that, children fail to listen to mom. Mom doesn't want to hear dad, and dad has problems with all of his bosses. But the truth of the matter is that wherever you are, God would have you to bring value to that relationship. The example I give is this $5 bill. When this $5 bill is over my hand, it does not become a $10 bill. And when the $5 bill is under my hand, it does not become a $2 bill. It holds its value wherever it is. And God would have in our jobs, in our homes, in our schools, that we would bring value whether we are in authority or whether we're under authority. First Peter says it best, that if you will humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that in due season he'll put you in. Bring value wherever you are, that God might be glorified in all that we do. This is Pastor Philip White, and this has been a Regenerated Moment. Well, we are back on A Mother's Cry. Hope you were blessed by that. That was a Regenerated Moment from yours truly, Pastor Philip White, pastor of the Regenerated Church in the city of Los Angeles, California. I am here at a table full of anointed gospel preachers. Man, I almost checked out today. Just let them have this show and let them go on about their business. I'm here, as always, with Brother Sam, with Elder Sam Darling, with Pastor Max Zeal, and I'm here with Superintendent Kevin Moreland. We're getting some good comments. Pastor Evangelist James Cornegay is watching. Sister Jeanette Boyles is watching. Sister Denisha Sims is watching. My beautiful wife, Sister Glory Ann White, is watching.
Hey,
oh, Lord. Yeah. You're talking about men, but I'm going to have to dismiss. Just a second and get out of here. We love him all with the love of the Lord. Gentlemen, I want to talk about the church's responsibility to minister to the lives of men? Do we have a responsibility to minister to the lives of men? And if we do, what should our ministry be to the life of men? Most of us, I won't say most of us, I can't speak for everybody church, but most of African-American churches are largely predominantly women in those churches. And so we got to be specific. And I believe that men's day is a little bit more than us on the fifth Sunday with ties on that look alike, us marching in, giving us our offerings. What should the ministry of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ be to men, and what areas should we be hitting? Talk to me. Y'all don't all jump in at once. Come on, whoever. You're the guest. Let's go with the guest.
Yeah, no
the
problem. Guest. God bless you.
Yes, sir.
What I've learned, Pastor White, is that when we look at a human is a tripartite being, meaning it consists of three parts. It has a body, a soul, and a spirit. For so many years, church has been spiritual, and we have been so emotional in our spiritual approach, and that's very difficult for some men to come to grips with. And so what we've established in our church, we've established not only an inreach, but we've established an outreach as it relates to making sure we minister to the whole man. Men who deal with the problems of subjection. I believe that's one of the problems that men deal with is the subjection, meaning submitting. The Bible talks about that in John. The Bible said this is the verdict, that light has come into the world, but men love darkness because their deeds are evil. And so in order for us to win the men, we have to bring them to a place of accountability where they understand that there's somebody that's higher than them. The Bible says in the book of Romans, it talks about when they knew God, they glorified not God. And so men are caught up in so many things, and so we have to make sure that we reach them where they are, and we have to let them know that we're not just trying to preach to them, we're trying to reach them.
Yes, sir.
And men usually need to be up under teaching. The effects of teaching usually win men over. Men are different than women because we're dealing with a man and woman, we're dealing with the right brain, left brain. A woman is an emotional thinker, a man is a logical thinker.
Yes.
And so when you come to church and you emotionalize a man, it's very difficult for him to kind of relate to that. Because he's a logical thinker, we must show him the rudiments and the precepts. And not only show him, we got to live it by example.
In front of him.
And,
yes, sir.
And the pastor, yes, just can't seem like he is the head of a pyramid scheme.
Yes, sir.
To where he's coming up off the backs of the 80% of the congregation, which are women.
Yes, sir.
And so we have to let the men know that, no, we're right there with you. And so we have to have mentorship programs to where we go out and we show them what is a real man. A real man is a God-fearing, God-serving,
yes, sir,
God-walking,
yes, sir,
man.
Yes, sir.
They don't have that perception. They're emulating the men that are on the corner, drinking, smoking. And the perception of most men is that to be a man, you've got to have some jewelry, a nice car, and seven girlfriends. That is not the biblical precept of what a man is.
Come on, talk
the biblical precept of a man is a man that's walking in the fear and the admonition of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And so we have to be an example of that in our churches so that we can reach the men and let them know it's not just about being emotion, it's about doing the work of the Lord.
Yes, sir. Pastor McZeal, you wanna hop in on that one?
Yes, I certainly can. Definitely, again, the man, in order to be active within the church, again, he needs to see an example.
Yes, sir.
And that's why I went back, you know, to, we started by that family, because listen, it starts at a young age. When you see the young people, the men, young people see their fathers, and then that is embedded into them. And when they have that, then when they grow up, then they can become the men that God has called them to be. But the problem is they don't see the example. And so the only example that we really have now, and I must say that it's in the church,
yeah,
the pastor. And we need to make sure as pastors that we conduct ourselves. And as we go back to the scripture where it says, love your wives. Amen. The pastor has to show that passionate to his wife. And so that the men,
yes,
that they can be there again, and he has to be able to counsel those other women, amen. Because amen, most of the women, or a lot of the women in our churches are married, and they have husbands that are at home, And the thing that they cannot do, here it is that they cannot go back and say, well, Pastor said this.
Come on. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know?
Yes, sir.
And sir, and no, because listen, he is the head of that house. And ladies, we got to make sure that we let them know and build them up and not tear them down.
Yes, sir.
And that's why the one of the other ways that we can get them into the church.
If I can hop in real quick, we got our question. We got a hot one, so I got to give us some time on this one. The book of Ephesians says to speak the truth, but to speak it in love. The question from Facebook Live is, how does the church deal with homosexuality when it comes to men? What is our answer when it comes to the homosexual epidemic when it comes to men? Ephesians 4 tells us to speak the truth, but to speak it in love. So in a loving, not when we don't speak the truth, but we speak it lovingly. What is the biblical position? I think I know what everybody here is going to answer, but I'm going to let you answer it. What is the biblical position that we have when we're speaking to men when it comes to the subject of...
Let me, if you don't mind, jump into that real quick.
As the senior man at the table, we'll let you go ahead and start.
I know that Pastor Moreland really wants to get on there, but let me share this here. That to speak the truth, homosexuality is sin.
Yes, sir.
It's sin. We got to call it what it is. It's sin. Okay. Now, we love the sinner and we hate the sin. So at my church, everyone is welcome.
Yes, sir.
I don't care what your problem is. Listen, watch this. The Bible says all have sinned and come short.
Yes, sir.
You know, just because we want to point out the homosexual, or we want to point out the drug addict. Listen, the Bible says to know to do good and do it not, that's sin.
Yes, sir.
Amen. So we got folk that are in the church that are sinning and don't realize that they're not, but they want to point the finger at everybody else. But listen, everybody is welcome, but we cannot condone, amen, homosexuality, because it is a law. It is a sin, I should say, against the law of God. And so, but we love you.
Yes, sir.
We love you. But you just need, and some places, well, I was born that way. Well, you know what my answer to that is? You need to be born again.
All right. Reverend Darling, come on. Speaking of truth and love, we all are, but go ahead.
Yeah, I can't add a whole lot to that. I mean, it is indeed sin, and we have to call sin, sin. And as preachers and as men of God, we have to be careful and fair to preach just as we preach against homosexuality, to preach against drunkenness, to preach against adultery, to preach against lewd and lascivious behavior, to preach against pornography. We have to preach against all those things. I think where sometimes the spotlight gets shined on us to our detriment is that we'll beat up on that one sin,
yes, sir.
And we won't talk about those sins that, you know, we tend to do, quiet as it's kept sometimes. You know, lying is a sin. Yes. All those things are sins. And so we cannot minimize these other sins over here and then become the homosexual bashing preacher over here. It's a sin, and we should preach on it just as strongly, just as clearly, but like we do with those other things in a loving manner.
Yes, sir. You wanted the back. I feel you wanted the back cleanup.
I know he's trying to get
he
in.
He wants the back cleanup.
I cut it short.
I'm listening and learning.
He wants the back cleanup.
I'm listening and learning. But listen, let me, since you put the spotlight on me, I will chime in on it.
Okay.
First, let me start off by somewhat defending the church, then I'll kind of address the homosexuality.
Yes, sir.
Now, what we must realize is the Bible said a broken heart and a contrite spirit he will in no wise cast out. What we have to be careful about, where the church takes a beating, because they say, well, we preach on that. Well, from my experience, a lot of times, if I was smoking marijuana, I wouldn't come to church with a joint in my ear. If I was an alcoholic, I probably wouldn't come to church with Night Train in my suit jacket. And so when I come to church, I understand I have weaknesses. And I'm coming to a place where I want the Spirit of God to address those so that I could be healed. Sometimes on the opposite side, there is a flamboyancy and there is no contrition. And when we come to the house of the Lord, we all have sinned. We've all come short of the glory. But there needs to be contrition. Sure. So we can never fall into the trap to where I'm going to accept that you are a weed head, that I'm going to accept that you're an alcoholic. And I'm going to act like I don't see the joint in your ear. I'm going to act like I don't see the night train in your coat pocket. No, we will address that. And if that became a major issue where people were flaunting their sins in the house of God, I think we would preach just as vehemently against that as other things. So we got to be very careful. And the person that is struggling with homosexuality, they must know that when they come to the house of the Lord, we're there to help. We're there to heal. And so if we see certain things, we will address it. So now God speaks clearly about all sin. And homosexuality is just a sin of many sin.
Amen.
And so we have to address it as such. And with love and kindness have I drawn thee. And so we have to express to those who are in any type of sin that we love you. And the best thing that we have to make them understand is that we have come from a life of sin ourselves.
Come on, sir.
And it may
come
not
on,
be
sir.
What you are struggling with,
but one.
Just because I have this
Amen.
Robe on,
yes,
the prodigal son who came back home, what I noticed is that when he came back home, they gave him his robe, they gave him his ring, and Amen. They had a party. But what I realized is that if he had been down there with those pigs, mm-hmm. it doesn't show me anywhere where they washed him or gave him a bath. So it lets me know with all of our garments, the thing we must understand, up under all the beauty that we have become now, is still some mess up under there also.
Right.
And so we have to be cognizant of the fact that we have to love everybody that walks through those doors. And we have to express the image of God and let them know, look, we're not here to throw darts, and this is not a place where we fire bullets at anyone. We are coming to bring you the bread of life.
Yes, sir.
And the same God that healed us, his blood still works.
Yes, sir. Are we not being blessed by this program on today? These fine and awesome and amazing preachers are here blessing us. We're doing great on Facebook Live, and I'm sure you're watching, streaming on air. We got one more break, and then we're going to come back, and we're going to talk about our next generation men. We're going to pray for those men that are out there that are far from God and believe that God's going to do some great and awesome things. We'll be right back on The Mother's Cry.
Good afternoon. This is Minister Shirley Knight Harris coming to you with The Mother's Cry. I thank you very much for supporting this ministry, but I'm in need of your help. I need to develop a board of director. If you would like to be on the board, please call me at 310-748-0610. Or you may go to my website at eskhm.org. It's very important that in order for us to continue to reach our young people, through Mother's Cry, we're on every Thursday from 2 to 3. I need you to call in, and you may call in at 323-965-1600. You may call in. Or you may send your donations in through my post office box. And if you're not sure how to do that, you can reach me on my website or my email. And my email is eskhm@sbcglober.net. This is a nonprofit organization, and you would be able to deduct your donation off of your taxes. And we thank you very much. Again, this is Mother Stry reaching out to mothers and fathers that have lost their children to drugs, incarcerated, being murdered, pimps, prostitution, drug dealers, and so forth, letting you know that God loves you and Jesus died for you. We're on every Thursday from 2 until 3. And thank you very much. Again, this is Minister Shirley Knight Harris.
God bless you. We are back on A Mother's Cry. I know you've been blessed. I know you have been uplifted. You've been strengthened as we have been going through this broadcast, talking about the kingdom man and the kingdom of gender. Well, pastors, we have talked about God's kingdom man. We've talked about the ministry of the church to the whole man. But now we want to take on a few remaining minutes to talk about the next generation man. What do we do to invest into the seed that's coming up? To ensure that some of the same things that tripped us up, some of the same things that caused us to fall and stumble will not go. I am a father that has a son. I have a seed. And so I'm determined by the power of God that some of the things that I went through My Son Will Not Go Through. Let's talk real briefly about our ministry to the young man who's dealing with some different stuff. He's dealing with social media. He's dealing with pornography. He's dealing with a higher, not a different devil, but a more sophisticated devil than the devil that we dealt with. If it ain't weed, it's vaping. It's just always something that's always trying to attach the next seed. What is our ministry? What is our word? What is our mission to the next generation?
Well, I would say, I don't know if you...
come on.
I would just say that our ministry really hasn't changed. It's been the same from the beginning. We as men have to stand up and be men.
Yes, sir.
Again, it was my generation, and I fell out with a lot of people my age because I said it was my generation that really dropped the ball because we went to jail in record numbers like no other generation before ours. My father was in the home, and our fathers were in the homes. And, you know, them and mama might not have been speaking. They might not even been sleeping in the same room. But they stayed in the homes. They stayed there to protect their homes. They stayed there to raise their children. They stayed there to show their young men how to be men. And I think we have to start there. Our churches as institutions should have mentoring programs for young men. There are many, like you mentioned, I forget the percentage, which says something like the church is made up of 60% women or 70% women, and
some
it varies.
Some of them are a little bit higher.
Yeah,
than that,
it varies. It varies from time to time, but it is largely made up of women. Many of them who are single mothers raising man childs, the best way they can, and it's really not enough. There needs to be a man, and we, as preachers and elders teachers and just brothers in the church, need to reach out and help those women, help them raise those men, mentor those young men, because if we don't do it, who will do it?
Right.
Yes, sir.
If we don't do it, the street will do it. If we don't do it, the what social media will do it.
Yes,
Facebook will do it. And I ain't mad at none of y'all on Facebook. Except.
Don't get my audience mad at me. I'm just joking.
I'm simply saying that just like we can do good on Facebook, it's a tool.
Yes, sir.
It's a tool like any other tool. And like the brother said, there's so many things, weed and cocaine and this and that. All those things were to be placed under our dominion. You see, and so if we misuse them, we misuse them. Narcotics under our dominion are used as anesthesia, as
yes,
he
sir.
Said. You know what I mean? So it's a tool like anything else, Facebook, all these various different things. But if we don't teach them how to be men, the streets will. And the streets will teach them be a version of a man,
yes, sir.
But not a man.
Not a real man. Pastor McZeal, what is our ministry to young men? What are we telling our young men that are coming up?
In the book of Proverbs, it says, train up a child while they're young, so that when they're old, they will not depart. I believe that, again, the training of young men, just a testimony on my son. I have a son that now is 34 years old, and he was raised in the church. He was brought up in the church, went to college, and then got stupid.
College is where
that's where it happened.
Yeah. College.
It's a myth. It's always a place of higher learning. That's not necessarily true.
I again want him, of course, to be in the church, and I'm always telling him, you need to be in church. You need to. But the Lord put it on my heart, rather than to push it that way, to invite him to church. And surprisingly, I must say, in the last several weeks, that he's been really coming aboard. He's excited about the Lord now. Things are changing his life because we went from trying to tell them that he needs to go to church, and instead inviting them.
Yes, sir.
And so sometimes we need to step back and take a look at the full picture and begin to ask the Lord, Lord, how can I act in this area of bringing my son, bringing my daughter, whoever the case may be, to church, because we want them to know the Lord. We want them to have a relationship with Him, and we want them to prepare. And that's the thing that, you know, we need to make sure that we're doing is, again, that we're preparing them. And the way that, again, going back where it starts though, is when they're young.
Yes,
put it inside of them, and once they got inside of them, and then they may depart. They may go and sow their wild oats, as young people do, but they're always going to come back. As you mentioned before, there's so many things now that are biting for their attention. And really, and I hit it there, is that we need to make sure that we give them that attention.
Yes, sir.
Because they're looking. And that's most important, to give them that time that that they're looking for. And I think if we do that, I think that we can, again, get our young people back into the church.
Superintendent, we got 2 minutes.
Sure. The Bible said, if our gospel be hid, it is hid from them whom the God of this world has blinded their eyes, lest they should believe. So what we have to do is remind the young men who they are. When we talk about the word kingdom, it comes from the Greek word basileia. It means rank, rule, and authority. So we got to let the young brothers know where they rank on this planet. We have to let them know what's God's rule and that they have authority, that they outrank plants, fish, and fowl of the air. You must know who you are. You must understand that you're better than how you have been living. Yes. You must understand that God has created you to have rule, to have authority and dominion. Rada. He put you here to be over things, but not under things. Yes, you are the head, not the tail, the above only, and not the beneath. You should be the lender and not borrowers.
Great stuff. We've started my Hearts program at my church called Boys to Men, in which we are really taking an active role in young men's life in our church. I am a product of a single home, and it was good to have men at my church to pull me to the side and talk about basic principles.
Amen.
Yeah, get saved. Yeah, get filled with the Holy Ghost. But how to balance a checkbook.
Yes.
How to put air in a tire.
Right.
How to fix a flat. How to pump gas.
How to tie a tire.
Yeah. When there's a bump at night, that your mama ain't the one can always go downstairs and answer the door. And so I am encouraged, and I am challenged by, arrested by the Spirit of God to give some of our young men just practical principles for living. The other day, I pulled up to the gas station, and this young lady was out pumping her gas, and I'm going to call him her boyfriend, something. He was in the car in the passenger seat texting. I wanted to first snatch him. Forgive me, Jesus. And then after, I wanted to snatch her. Sis, how in the world are you driving this joker around? Come on now. And he won't even get out. I'm sure if he wasn't pumping it, he wasn't paying for it neither. Come on, y'all. Y'all know him, right? You know him, right?
Yes, you are.
You know him, right? And so to have men that are actually men other than what's between their legs, I believe we got to have men that have skill sets, that have trades, that have something going for them other than their muscles, their abs, and how tall they are. And so I believe that God will cause us as kingdom men to invest in young men, that they can do as Adam was encouraged to do, to have dominion, to reign. Yes. Adam wasn't given trees, he was given seed.
Yes.
And he was told Hallelujah. To take that seed and cause that seed to become substance.
Yes.
Young man, a job ain't gonna come knocking on your door. Opportunities will not come and overtake you and snatch PlayStation out of your hand. You're going to have to get up, turn the TV off, and allow God to lead you to his wealthy place. Well, we believe that all men have been blessed by this. I want to real quickly go to my guests. They both are pastors planted in areas in which this broadcast is going to go. Take a second, if you could. Just let us know your address, service times, if something that's going on that you would like to invite the people to. Pastor McZeal, let us know what's going on at Living Waters. Real quick.
Living Waters, in city of Fontana. Address is 13710 Arrow Route, Fontana, California, corner of Marbury and Arrow. And one of the things that we're excited about, and real briefly, we have men's prayer, 6 o'clock in the morning, from 6 to 7, every Thursday, the men are in charge, leading prayer. If you have a chance, get on that prayer line. Number is 712-432-1500. The access code is 458-453. Call in and join us at that time.
Give it to us just a little bit slower. Give it to us one more time if you don't mind. Yeah. You're doing good, but they're right. They're trying to write. Give it to us one more time.
712-432-1500. And the access code is 458-453. Join in every Thursday between 6 a.m. and 7 a.m.
What's going on at Worship and Truth?
A lot.
Yes, sir.
But I'll just share with you a few things. Listen, I want you to be excited about what we're doing. We're located at 1520 Southeast Street. in the beautiful city of San Bernardino, California. On July 30th, we have Adopt a Young Man, and that will be our Summer Slam, Summer Jam festival that we're having. We're giving out 1,000 backpacks to the young people in the area. We'll have a big wrestling ring there. We have two preachers that'll be wrestling. I'll be the guest referee. We'll let young people know that you can slam everything that's wrestling you. Yes, and so we're going to have an awesome time with that. Also, if you are on social media, I have a Men's Mondays. It's called Men's Mondays with Moreland. I do that every Monday at 7 o'clock p.m. On that program, I'm talking about some of the things that we have coming up. I work with Khalid Shad down here in Los Angeles with the Stop the Violence, Increase the Peace. And we are actively going into the streets and the communities trying to repel gang violence. We also have an upcoming event that I'll be speaking to more about. If you listen to my Men's Mondays on Mondays at 7 o'clock p.m., we have what's called Gone But Not Forgotten. And this is a luncheon that we're going to have on a quarterly basis for all of the mothers whose child has been killed by the victim of violence, and we're going to let them know your child may be gone, but you have not been forgotten, and some of the collateral mental issues that you're dealing with as a result of the losing of your child. We're going to have counselors there to help you get through the tragic, ignominious death that your child experienced through the loss of gang violence. You need to get in with us. We got boots on the ground. I'm your boy KT Moreland. You need to holler at me on these Men Mondays every Monday at 7 o'clock p.m. God bless y'all. Love you real, real, real good.
Thank you so much, you both, for coming and joining us on today. I'm truly sure that you have been blessed, you have been elevated, and you have been stirred up in your most holy faith. Ladies, if you know a man who needs to look at this program, show him the replay. And brothers, if you're out there and you've been watching, I pray that the Spirit of God has arrested your heart, your spirit, and your mind. Father, we thank you for the word that have gone forth. We thank you for our guest that has been used as a vehicle and vessel to communicate your love and the power of your gospel. That if they were looking for a man, you sent a man, and his name was Jesus.
Yes.
And he died for the sins of every man, that if we would just confess and believe in our heart, that we shall be saved. And so I pray for every brother under the sound of my voice, whether they are this generation or the next generation to come, they will be the royal seed that you have called them to be. We'll give you all the glory and all the honor for everything that you're going to do in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. And we thank you for it in advance. I'm Pastor Philip White, your guest host of the Mother's Cry. Until next week, go with God and God will go with you. Yeah. God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
gonna put your hands together right here. Hey, yeah. Feels like Sunday morning, old school, right?